I said, good morning. We're so glad you're here this afternoon. we're going to sing a couple songs, three songs, I guess. And we're really going to need your guys' help, okay? So if you guys want to stand and sing with us.
Thank you.
kidding. It's John Mark McKinley. When I worked at Williams Baptist, I had the opportunity to get to meet John Mark McMillan. Does anybody know who that is?
No.
All right. He is Jesus. Kid. No. He is the man who wrote How He Loves. And the song How He Loves, everyone pretty much knows, right? He basically wrote that song as a conversation with God. And he said, when I met him in that picture, he said, when I wrote that song, I sat down to have a conversation with God. And what happened was, God ended up having a conversation with me, a dialogue with me. And so, when we think about worship, worship is a conversation with God. Songs are a conversation with God. And so I just want to challenge you right now, when you sing this song, just think of it as your conversation with God and His conversation.
Wait, it's wind and mercy.
think about how strong Hurricane is. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I'm unaware of the afflictions, eclipsed by glory. This is my favorite part. When the guy in the picture was writing a song, he said, "I realize just how beautiful you are." So he's saying that to God. But then God is saying, "I realize how beautiful you are, despite your afflictions, despite your flaws." And then he says, "And how great your affections are for me." So how great your love is for me. And God is saying the same thing to us. How great your affections are for me.
Schedule. That place is filled with a bunch of hypocrites. I was forced by my parents to go to church every week when I was a child, and now it is time to take a break. I've heard all kinds of excuses as a pastor, and even one as the pastor's too long-winded. All the restaurants are full by the time we get out of church. Amen. I got an amen there. Every reason imaginable is given why people are not willing to commit themselves and their lives to Christ. And the Bible tells us to forsake not the assembling of ourselves, for this is thus to come together and to worship God in the congregation. And when we come together and we worship God in the congregation, is we put all of the excuses behind us. We put them back into this world and we say, you know what? I'm not going to let the excuses of this world hold me back from doing what God has called me to do. Yeah. We find in the Bible in Luke chapter 14, verse 15, and this is where we're going to be for just a little bit. We find some excuses because even in Christ's day, this is nothing new to Jesus as people come up with excuses. For even Jesus tells his disciples that there are people that make excuses and what God's reaction is to excuses. Whoa, we're fixing to find out that God does not like our excuses while we do not serve him. The Bible says that you have been bought, you have been paid for, that a price has been given for your life. And that price that has been given for your life is that you are now royalty, that you belong to God, that he paid for you. It says that you are a new creation through Christ Jesus, and therefore, that new creation that we are in Christ Jesus is that we should be a flame, a fire in this world, burning bright for Christ, for we are that city that is set up on a hill. And if we are not that city that is set up on a hill that's shining bright for Christ, that our works, now wait a second, works, the things that we do for Jesus, the things that when we go into the world that we do things to lead people to the throne of God. The Bible tells us that we've all been given a ministry. You've all been called to the ministry. Every one of us. There's a calling on your life. And that calling in the ministry for every single one of us that is a Christian, that Christ has paid the debt for your sin. Sin. One. Sin. He paid the debt for your sin. And therefore, he has given you a ministry. Maybe you're not a preacher, or you're a pastor, or you're an evangelist. Maybe you're none of those, but what you do have is you have a ministry of bringing people to Jesus. However that may be, you have a ministry of bringing people to Jesus. And so, however that is if it's just grabbing somebody by the arm and saying, come on, you're going with me to church, or you're going with me to meet Jesus, I'm taking it. You know, there's some big people in this world, you can still get them to church. Just like this little old lady here, she just told her husband he was going to church whether he liked it or not. In Luke chapter 14, verse 15, he says, one of those who reclined at the table with him heard these things. He said to him, blessed is everyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God. Blessed is everyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God. Now think about this for a second. To eat bread in the kingdom of God. This means, I'm going to borrow your story. This means that we pull a chair up with everybody else to whose table? Say it again. God's. We pull our chair up to God's table and we eat bread with God. And he is saying, blessed is everyone that pulls up to the table with God and eats bread. And so therefore, when we pull up to God's table, for we didn't earn a position at God's table, we was invited to God's table. Yeah. And so therefore, if you make an excuse not to pull up to God's table, guess what? It is not anybody else's fault but your own. And this is the problem with a lot of people is they make excuses. Well, he said or she said or they did or I don't go to that church because of or that church, they believe in this so I don't go there. Well, guess what? It is your responsibility to work out your salvation with fear and trembling before God Almighty. It is not my responsibility to work out your salvation. It is your responsibility to work out your salvation. It is your responsibility to keep yourself in the love of God. It is on ourselves. And therefore, if you do not take the responsibility that God has given you, then guess what? You will be the one who's given an answer to God. All I have to do is tell you what your responsibility is as a pastor. In verse 16 it says, but he said unto them, A man once gave a great banquet and invited many. And at the time for the banquet, he sent his servant to say to those who had been invited, "Come, for everything is now ready." But they all began to make excuses. Now I want to take a time out right here, and I want to explain to you who prepared the banquet. Whose table did by this table we pulled up to? God's. God is the one that's prepared the banquet. Who is the servant that he sent out to invite those to his banquet? Jesus. Jesus is the one that he sent out to invite people to the banquet. And therefore, when Christ went out to invite everyone to God's table, that we have been carried to God's table, we have been placed at his table, and therefore a banquet has been set in front of us for us to have a feast. We've been carried to God's table, and therefore we didn't earn a place there. We have been invited and chosen to have a place there. And therefore, when we are invited to God's table, there are those that Christ, he invites to God's table, and they begin to make excuses of why they don't come to God's table. Well, guess what? That is every one of us, because every one of us has made some kind of excuse in our life. Why not to serve God? Why not to be the church? Why not to have unity? Why not to worship God with freedom? Why not to be the person that God has called us to be in this world? We begin to make excuses. And the bad part is a lot of times we start pointing the fingers at others to be our excuse. The cost of commitment is time. Most of us are too busy. The Bible tells us that we are busybodies, going to and fro, accomplishing nothing. The Wednesday before last, I was teaching on the crown of righteousness. And one of the things that I brought up in that lesson that we were talking about, the crown of righteousness, is that life that we live, there's a righteousness that we have been imputed, a righteousness that we have been adopted into, and that's the righteousness of Christ. That is not the crown of righteousness that he's talking about. The crown of righteousness that he's talking about is that when we live a righteous life, and that righteous life is going and doing the ministry that we were called to do, that is the righteous life he's talking about. Yes, we will still make mistakes. Yes, we will still sin. But it is what we are doing along the way and how we respond to the sin that we have in life. What is your response? This busyness that we have, or so we think that we have. We're busy with family, we're busy with friends, we're busy with work, we're busy with sports, we're busy with volunteering for different things in life. We're busy cleaning, we're busy cooking, we're busy sleeping. We're busy, 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 busy. We're busy people. Are we busy about the kingdom of heaven? I want to show you the rest of the story. It says that they all begin to make excuses. The verse said that him I have bought a field and I must go and see it. Please have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yokes of oxen. I go in to examine them. Please have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore cannot come. So the servant came and reported these things to the master. Then the master of the house became angry. Whoa, who's the master of the house? We just talked about this. He's the one that sent his servant to go and invite those that were chosen to the feast. Well, guess who the chosen ones are? The Jews. The Jews are the chosen ones. They said no. So the master of the house sends his servant back into the world to invite us. Tells him to go into the highways and the hedges. Told him to go into and invite all that would come. Let's keep reading. The master of the house came angry and said to his servant, go out quickly to the streets and lanes of the cities and bring in the poor and crippled and the blind and lame. And the servant said, sir, what you commanded has been done, and still there is room. And the master said to the servant, go out to the highways and the hedges and compel people to come in, that my house may be filled.
Yeah.
God wants his house filled, because when God's house is filled, it means there are people that have pulled up to the table of God, and there are people being fed the word of God. There are people that are yet at the feast of God, and therefore when they are at the feast of God, they receive from God what they need in life. We are starving Christians in this world, as we can hear the best sermons, we can sing the best songs and worship God. But when we leave the place of God that we have met and that and we have come together to worship, what are we doing with the rest of our days in this world? Are we feeding ourselves at the banquet of Christ? Or are we coming to church and being fed and then starving the rest of the week? This is where we have to get on our knees, and it tells us in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people would humble themselves and pray. This isn't something that we just do on Sunday. This is something that we have to do every day of our life, is that we have to humble ourselves and pray and seek God's face and turn from our wicked ways. And therefore, that is when we have been pulled up to the table of God and said, okay, God, I'm a humble servant.
Yeah.
Feed me. I need you. Man, this past week, you know, it's been about 3 years since we went on a vacation. Year before last is, yeah, I took a vacation from work, but last year we had a week-long church camp at church. When you have 40 kids, 50 kids, that is not a vacation. I went back to work to get some rest. Don't shake your heads. The year before that, we went to New Mexico on a mission trip, drove 17 hours straight to New Mexico, worked a full week doing mission work, and we put on a church camp, or a vacation Bible school at the park, and also did mission work throughout the week in cleaning the park and doing things for the community in Albuquerque, New Mexico. 17 hours of driving with a van full of people that sleep is tiring, because you're sitting there, the only one awake, about 14 hours into the ride, and think, you know what, I'm going to get them. They're all asleep. So you know those little bumps on the side of the road that make the car go. I hit all those bumps, and I started yelling. This man had come out of our chair. But you know, we make excuses of why we don't go do stuff. We make excuses, well, 17 hours away is too far to go into mission work. Or 40 or 50 kids in the building of the church is too many kids to have there. But we have to do away with those excuses, because guess what? We are in a world of people that are dying and going to hell because we have become lazy.
Amen.
Oh, I didn't just say you become lazy. I said we have become lazy. And so this past week, what I was saying when we were on vacation is every day I wore my Journey shirt. My Journey t-shirt. And you wouldn't believe how many conversations I got to have with people because of my Journey t-shirt. They was like, well, where's Journey Church? And I would tell them, and I would say, hey, it's a church plant in Perryville. And, you know, we started in September 24th of last year. And, you know, we're not even a year into it. And I got to tell them about what God was doing. And if I keep going, I'm going to get into my message for 3 o'clock, so I'm going to stop there. But, you know, we can make excuses of why we don't invite people to church. We're a new thing in Perry County. And when there's a new thing, guess what? There's going to be some new rumors. And so we have to distinguish. We have to get in here, and just like Christ, that God sent Christ to go because of those that said no, the Jews said no. And Jesus, he sent Jesus back in, and he told him, he said, to go into the streets, into the lanes, into the city. And he says, bring the poor, the crippled, the blind, the lame, and the servant. Said, there's still room. Look around this room. Seriously, if you have my permission to turn around and look back at the back and look at the front, we have plenty of room. We can fit another 50 chairs in this room. I've already measured. And so it is our mission, it is our work to go. There is 80% of the people in Perry County that do not go to a church service. That we want to bring them into the house of God, and we want to pull them up a chair and say, look, look, that's yours.
Amen.
That is yours. There's my God. There's the one that saved you. Your best sermon that you have in your life right now, your best sermon is your testimony.
Amen.
Your testimony. You don't have to study and put together 5 pages of notes to go preach a sermon to somebody in this world. The best testimony that you have is that when you tell somebody, I'm a sinner. And Jesus came to me. Jesus drew me to Him. Jesus showed me that He paid a price for me. Christ is the one that filled me. Christ is the one that feeds me. Christ is the one that gave me access. When the bell was rent, when the curtain was pulled to the side, and Christ gave us access to the Holy of Holies, is that He wants that place filled with people before the Holy of Holies seeking God's face. It's because when we get people into the Holy of Holies and we show them who God Almighty is, guess what? Our families begin to be changed for the glory of God. We're going to teach this out. I'll say that. Now y'all say amen.
Amen.
Okay, now y'all say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24. On this Sunday, today starts the day, is that we stand with Christ and we stop making excuses. We stand with one another and we stop making excuses. As I got to church this morning, and you know, everybody deals with things in life, that we all have things that we go through. And I went to the front door of this place, and I got the anointing oil, and I went up there, and I prayed over the doors of this church. I anointed the doorpost, over the top of the door, and I just prayed. And usually when I pray, and y'all might think this is weird, is I don't close my eyes. I pray to a living God that wants us to see Him, and so therefore, my eyes were wide open. I was looking out those front doors, and I was just praying for the ministry that God has called us to be, and to be the church that He's called us to be, to be the people that He's called us to be, just praying for you. And I was looking out those doors, there was a beautiful rose, several beautiful roses, several beautiful flowers out there. But God said, "Danny, you see this rose, how it blooms?" I said, "Well, yes, God, I see that rose." And I'm standing there, and Thomas was praying on the front doors, and he says, "This is how my church is to be in the world. It is a blossom. It is something beautiful that when people look at, it is like this rose. It is beautiful." And he says, "You know, and I'm not a, what do they call those, the green thumbs? What are they called? Or what? Horticulturalists." But he said, "You know, sometimes as those dead ends have been pruned away, right?" I'm looking at you because you know more about it than I do. That's correct. And he says, "But when they're pruned away, that means even beautiful, more beautiful flowers grow." Yes. And so when God starts to prune away some of those things that are dead around us, is that we can even be a better blossom for God. Dead around us, that we may grow. That we may be a beautiful blossoming rose before the people of this world to see. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 24. He says, actually, I want to start with verse 19. It says, "Therefore, brothers," and he's talking about family. That word brothers means family. "Therefore, family of mine, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus," we've been invited. We have access through the blood of Jesus. "And therefore, by the new and living way that He opened for us through the curtain, that is through His flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full of assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For He who promised is faithful, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works." To stir up one another. This means is to go and get people and to make them a part of what's going on. This is where we have to be in unity with one another, and that when we start making things, when we start doing the ministry of God, that we go get one another and we cause one another to do good things. Just like I said, when you come to church, man, it's you should leave all that junk that's going on in this world. You need to leave it at the altar, and you need to focus on who God is. You need to focus on how He does love you, how He has washed you, And he says that we have to consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglected, and meet together as the habit of some, but encouraging one another. Encourage. When's the last time you encouraged somebody? This is what we have to do as the church. We have to be encouragers. We have to lift one another up. Because guess what? There is enough things going on in this world that's keeping people pushed down. There's enough people in this world that's going to stir up strife. There's enough people in this world that's going to be naysayers. That can't be done. That's not possible. You're too small. There's not enough people. There's not enough money. There's not enough this. There's not enough that. Well, guess what? Look around you. God has given us something great in a matter of months.
Yes.
77 days from the day that we broke ground, we was having worship service in this church. 77 days.
Amen.
You tell that to people that is in construction, they're like, that is unheard of. That is not possible. And how we did it, that is impossible. Well, guess what? With God, the impossible is possible.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Get y'all away here. We excuse ourselves as scapegoats and blaming others. Adam blamed Eve, Eve blamed the serpent. It is not my fault. It never is. We need to accept our shortcomings and have God fix them. That's who can. Guess what? You can't fix yourself. I can't fix myself. We excuse ourselves by blaming our past. Well, I was involved in stuff in my past, so you know I can't, you know, God can't really use me anymore. Yes, He can. God is the one that, you look through His scripture, He took a murderer, an adulterer, and this man became a man that was after God's own heart, King David. He took another murderer and liar, Saul, and you have most of the New Testament. He went and planted churches throughout all, and then he did not only want to see those who poor and meek, but he also wanted to see kings receive promise. We excuse ourselves by blaming Satan. The devil made me do it. Now come on. The devil didn't make you do it. He just gave you opportunity to do it. He says that if we feed the Spirit, then the Spirit is what is stronger. Paul, he says, where do these wars come from? Where do they come from? The wars within myself. Where do these wars come from? And he goes to the point and says, this is the Spirit battling the flesh. The flesh comes up with all kinds of excuses. But the Spirit is willing. Is your Spirit willing? Are you willing? Are you feeding the Spirit more than you're feeding the flesh? Because it says that if you feed the Spirit, you will reap spiritual things. But if you feed the flesh, guess what? You will reap corruption.
Amen.
All the things that you do for God will be for naught. You'll come up with a reason why you don't need to do them anymore. You'll come up with a reason why I don't need to invite somebody to church. You'll come up with a reason why, you know what, that's just not for me. I'm not the preacher. Yeah, you are. We've all been given the ministry of reconciliation to proclaim the gospel. Guess what being a preacher is? Proclaiming the gospel. Hallelujah. For Christ came and paid a debt for us.
Amen.
A while ago when we was in the gospel, it says that the master of the house became angry because those that were chosen, I said, I don't want a part. What does that say about our faith in Christ when we make excuses? God knows us from the inside. He chooses us, guess what? From the inside. Not your outward appearance, but your inward appearance. How do you look on the inside? David was chosen because of what was inside of him, not for what his stature was, not for how he looked, not for how bold he was, or big he was, but for how bold he was in the kingdom of heaven. That he knew that God was his deliverer when he went before Goliath. And guess what? All these other men were afraid to stand before Goliath. Even King Saul said, here's my equipment, here's my armor, here's my sword, here's my stuff. And guess what King David said? I didn't earn that. But what I did earn, I have right here with me. A sling. And you know what? All I need is three of these. You know, some speculate is why he chose three, because David or Goliath had two other brothers. But one did the trick. He didn't make an excuse and walk out there to Goliath and say, that's a big guy. You know what? There's one of y'all. I want y'all to take care of this. No. Guess what? Goliath was talking bad about God, about God's people. And David wouldn't understand it. And neither should we. We have to stand. Bible says to stand that once we have put on the armor of God, that we are to stand against the wiles of the devil. This is the things that Satan throws at us. The excuses why we don't do the ministry that God has called us to. Are you willing to quit making excuses and serve God? Are you willing to live like you serve a living Savior? A God that it says that if you would have faith of a mustard seed, that you could say to this mountain, be thou removed and cast into the ocean, and then it would be done. He even told his disciples, is to go and proclaim the gospel. Don't take silver, don't take gold, don't take purse, don't take a script. Go on your journey and preach the gospel. Whoa. God didn't choose Jews first, but they didn't want to come to the table. How easy and convenient is it for us to blame everything and everybody else for the things that we're going through in our lives? It's always easier to say it's somebody else's fault than it is to say it's my fault. There is such a thing as being positive and being a great person with the best intentions toward everybody. To have a love that Christ loved us with, that we're loving others with. A love that when we go into the world is that we don't look to judge people, we look to love people. Most people, a lot of Christians are looking for an excuse. They're looking for a way out. They're looking for a why not. We have to stop making these excuses to be a successful Christian. And yes, you heard me say, successful Christian is to be a successful Christian is to totally rely on Christ. And when we're totally relying on Christ to make every move we make in this world, that is what it means to be a successful Christian. If we think that to be a successful Christian means to have the things of this world, then we've got our minds in the wrong place. To be a successful Christian is not to put our faith in our hearts and our treasures in earthly things, but to be a successful Christian is to put our faith, our heart, and our treasures in the kingdom of heaven. We have to stop being lazy and full of excuses. We are the reason that we are not growing and being successful in our alone lives. We are sitting on a pity party. We throw ourselves a little party of pity sometimes. Poor old pitiful me. We keep messing up. We live in the negative. We allow some of the dysfunctional things in our lives to control our lives. When Christ said, Daddy, you're a new creation. You have been set free. You no longer serve sin. You serve a living Savior. Then you no longer have to put your faith in what you can do, but you put your faith in what He can do. What Christ has done when He made access to the throne of God is that what Christ did for you, not what you can do for yourself. I know that I can go and do things for myself, but that means I exclude everything else in my life, that I need everybody to be a part of my life because I love you. And this is what Christ, this is what He has said. He doesn't need not one of us. He wants us. And He wants us to stop making excuses. He wants us to have a change of mind. He wants us to see who Christ is, who Christ has made. He has made us to be royalty. He has made us to be the chosen ones. He has made us to be righteous. He has chose you. It says, there is none righteous, no, not one, but the God of heaven has sent his Holy Spirit to draw you to the throne of God because of his love for you.
Amen.
We have to break that negative thinking, the negative spirit. We have to wake up and stop making these excuses. We have to start looking to God and make a reason why we should, instead of a reason why we shouldn't. We have to get our chair. No matter how far from the table we've moved our chair, we've got to take it back to the throne of God, where his table is, and enjoy the feast that God has prepared before us. One of my most favorite passages of scriptures or stories in the Bible about being carried to a table is when King David had made a promise to Jonathan, his best friend, that he would remember Jonathan when he became king. But Jonathan died. And David remembered the promise that he made Jonathan, that he would give him all of his father's inheritance when he became king and Jonathan had died. And so King David said, I want you to go and find somebody in the lineage kin to Jonathan. And so his servants come back and they tell King David, we have found somebody, but he's crippled. He can't get around. He's crippled. He can't walk. And King David looked at him and he says, I want you to get him. I want you to carry him to my table. I want you to prepare a feast for a king. And I want you to give him servants. I want you to give him lands. And I want you to tell him that all that he has, all that he sees is his. And all of these servants are going to work the fields of his father. And everything they work and do is his. Another passage of scriptures, these men, they had a buddy that was crippled. And they heard that there was a Christ, a Messiah, one that healed, one that had given sight back, one that had called these crippled people to be able to walk again. He had raised people from the dead. They had heard that there was a Messiah at a church, at a temple, giving a word of God. And so therefore they picked up his bed and they carried him to the temple. And as they carried him to the temple, they got closer and closer, and the place was too full. They couldn't get in there. They couldn't even get in the doors how packed the place was. Could you imagine the church so full because of the presence of God?
Amen.
It says that they crawled upon the roof, they peeled back part of the roof, and they lowered their friend and his bed down before the very presence of Jesus. And he said that when Christ, he said, your sins be forgiven, take up thy bed and walk. And he said, because your friends have brought you here, this has been done for you today. Who is your friends? Who is the people that you know in this world that they are crippled? Maybe they can walk, but they are crippled in their hearts, they are crippled in their lives. They do not know which way to go. Are you going to be the friend that carries their friend, their best friend, the people in their lives? Are you going to be the friend that carries them before the throne of God and says, here's my friend. Do what you do best and show them your love. Paul said he planted in Apollos water, God gave the increase. Are we planting? Are we watering? Or are we making excuses? I'm going to ask our worship team to get up here and get us in a song. But I want to do something different. I usually ask you to bow your head and close your eyes, but right now I want you to just look up to the heavens. And you maybe can't see the heavens right here, but I want you just to look to the throne of God. And I want you to ask him what he's to have you to do. Not what he has this person to do, or he has for this person to do, but what does he have for me to do? And if God lays something on your heart and you feel like you want to come up here to the altars, you feel like He's laid on your heart to go across the room and get somebody and to take them to the altars, or He's just telling you, you know what, just sit here and worship me. That's what I want you to do right now. It's exactly what God's telling you to do. And don't make an excuse why not. Because today is the day that we all are going to stop making excuses. Right now, what will you do?
I
I'm going to ask you to turn your lights on, Thomas. You know, we are a family. If you walk in the doors of this church one time, you're a family. If you come back a second time, that's your fault. I'm joking. But you know, the love that God has loved us with, and when he looks at us, he tells us, I love you. And I'm putting you in a place that I want you to be. You know what? A lot of times we think that we go to a certain place in life. But I believe that God puts us in places for a specific reason, at a specific time, to hear a specific message. And it's in his timing of what he's going to do with our lives. Whether he takes us home today or he waits another 1,000 years to take us home, it's in his perfect time. The thing is that we've got to do is we've got to be serious about the ministry he has placed us in. We have to take an urgency, because like I said, we don't know when it is that he's going to call us home. We don't know when it is that he's going to call our family home. We don't know. And so the urgency that we have to see those that we love, those that maybe we barely even know, those that we work with, maybe those that we're going to meet tomorrow, give us an urgency to tell those people about his love and how much he loves them, how much he loves us, and what he's done for us on our journey with him. This afternoon at 3 o'clock, we're going to talk about a vision that motivates. And that vision that motivates, I'm going to get into it just a little bit to get your interest level up. Is on September 24th, we met at the park in Perryville. It was a Wednesday night, and we sang a couple of songs, and then we went into a little short Bible study, and then we talked about the vision of Journey Church. And on September 24th, we had a vision of this building. We had a vision of a ministry that God was going to call us into in Perryville, Perry County, and even beyond. And to even be church planters, not just here in Perry County, but throughout Arkansas. Not just to plant a church right here in Perry County, but to go into other parts of Arkansas and plant the exact same thing that we're doing here in Perryville. And that's not a vision that has died. That's a vision that we're still walking in. But we can't make excuses of why to stop now.
Amen.
We've got to keep planting, keep watering, and keep bringing people into God's house that they will receive Christ.
Amen.
I'm going to ask you to stand on your feet, and we're going to dismiss with prayer. And before you leave today, I want you to know that I love you. I love you. And I'm going to tell you what, missing last Sunday and Wednesday, something when you have a calling on your life and you miss getting to preach, you can ask my family. Is they don't like me to miss preaching, but guess who I preach to when I miss preaching? My family. But I make a commitment, not only to God, but to you, that I'm always available. If you call me and I don't answer, it's more than likely I either have no phone service, or I'm in a meeting. Always know I'm approachable. If you have a concern, I'm always available. If you have something that is a desire in your heart to see in this church, I'm always open for discussion. But that doesn't mean we're going to change what God has given us to do. I will listen and pray. I want you to do the same things, because there's a lot of people in this room that needs prayer. There's a lot of people in our church that needs prayer. And you may be one of them, and we're going to pray for you. We have a prayer card back there in the back, and we have a prayer team that they get these cards and they pray over them. And if you want them to call you, they will either call you to pray with you or even come visit with you to pray with you. We have a team of people that does that. If you want to be on a prayer team, we will put you on a prayer team. We have a connection team that when you walk in the door, the people are there to greet you, give you a connection. When you walked in the first time, you should have received a pamphlet and the information card that you can put into the offering box in the back. And that's why we want to keep in touch. If you missed, we just want to keep in touch and say, hey, we missed you. you know. So if you want to be on that connection team, get with me. We have children's classes, a children's team. If you want to do anything in this church, you get with me and I'll put you in contact with the team leader of that team. And so with that, I'm going to pray. And if you've not met somebody here before, just don't dart out those doors really quick saying, okay, I got my church here for today. Go meet somebody for the first time. You know, you've maybe never seen them before. Maybe you've seen their face Sunday after Sunday, but you don't know who they are. Go meet them. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you today. Father, I thank you for this church. I thank you for this building that you've given us. Father, it is not ours. It is yours. Father, we just ask that we would be good stewards of what you've given us. Father, for the tithes and offering, that we would be a good steward of that. Father, that we wouldn't just use your word for naught, but Father, we would be a good steward of your word. Father, we would be a good steward of our lives. Father, we would stop making excuses, but Father, we would start living in your glory. Father, that you would be glorified, that our works would be seen in this county and beyond, and Father, that you would grow this church how you want it to grow. Father, we ask you that you would forgive us for our failures. And Father, give us an excitement and an encouragement to love with your love. Father, we love you, we praise you. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen.